I don't know what the world news is today or yesterday. Probably won't know what it is tomorrow. But I do know we have news here, which is real news. This, the worldly news is not real news. It's faux news, really. There's no truth to any of it, actually. But the news here, it has truth to it. Let us start with something rather astonishing. I realized today that contrast is not the lifeblood of some identity or life at all. However, we presume it is. More than presume, we demand that it is. We insist that it is. And this is all completely false. And we say, well, if we give up contrast and see everything as it truly is, which is, in terms of contrast, we say it's flat. There's no real contrast at all. That we would kill the life that contrast is sustaining. But contrast is not sustaining any life at all. So this is the extraordinary insight that came today. And from this, I entered into the wow, and I enjoyed it more than ever. It was much more elation than any trepidation. And I sort of stayed in this wow a lot of the day. It was a different experience for me, more profound than any I've had before. And it's like, oh my gosh, I'm really, really seeing through the whole thing. And I don't have to see contrast anymore. Polarity, contrast. So this is a huge, huge day. Now, drove around the Bay Area through all sorts of streets, freeways. It's all over the place today. Maybe 120 miles or something. And you know, I did not see a single American flag today. Not one. Not in any of the houses, not in any of the businesses. There was zero display, patriotic display, on Veterans Day. Nothing. That's rather astonishing. But here we are. Here we are. You see, things are changing, right? Maybe there's not many Americans left in the Silicon Valley, actually. That may be part of it, but no, there's still some. No flags, no display. Now, that's news right there. Google's icon for Veterans Day is also news, where they put the lone Caucasian male in the background as if he's an afterthought. On Veterans Day, and I mean, who is it that the cemeteries are full of? You know, I mean, I know that's Memorial Day, the fallen ones in fallen combat, but all those who have served, they put the the Caucasian male as an afterthought in the background is quite extraordinary social engineering, to say the least. It's so over the top and blatant that it's just shocking that I saw it. And the first thing just leapt out at me. I said, wait a minute, this is about all those who have served, first and foremost in combat. And then secondly, in supportive roles too, right? It's a big thing. Wow. Revisionism. Social engineering, it's just... That's a really big wow. So things are not the way they used to be. Everything keeps changing very, very rapidly. Attitudes have changed to an extraordinary extent. There's this, someone brings a dog into a store and the dog's jumping, a wild dog leaping all over the place, jumping on people, just harassing them, and the guy can't control the dog, he's jerking it around. I said, what? It was bothering me, and I said, what are you doing? I didn't say anything, but I said, my gosh, nobody says a word. I should have gone up to him and started witnessing to God, saying, hey, you can bring a dog into this business, this place. Well, I can bring God into this place too. You know what? If it got down to a confrontation, I guarantee you that they would have allowed the dog to stay and they would have kicked God out. No question about it. Sort of lost my wow there, because I was kind of like, I don't know what to say. I said, hey, we used to take dogs everywhere, and what we'd do, we'd tie them up outside. We'd put them somewhere, tie them to a tree, have a leash, tie them to a tree, and the dog would lie down. We'd say, lie down, stay. The dog would lie down, stay. When we'd come out, the dog would jump up and say, oh, nice to see you. And then we'd go on our way. I mean, it's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer. But no, people can't figure that out anymore. So that sort of put a damper on the wow. I was feeling this elation, this buzz, this very positive buzz. I got it back a little bit after. It took me quite some time to get it back, but I got it back a little bit. Now, the ego makes some extravagant claims, saying that contrast is feeding, is creating this other self. It even says, well, this is a eternal self. This is the one self. And I say, well, I'm going to put contrast down. And then the ego says, no, that'll kill the self if you do that. I say, wait a minute, is it eternal or is it, non-eternal? Is it so easily killed, At first the ego says, you can't set contrast down, it's impossible, that's reality. Then when you say, I'm going to do it, it says, well, don't do that, you're going to cause the loss of life if you do that. I say, what life? What are you talking about? Contrast is not causative. Contrast is just a belief, a definitional belief we have. It's arbitrary. Just like the belief that contrast is creating some self is completely arbitrary, made up, doesn't exist at all. There's actually no real evidence at all. We just misinterpret the evidence and then claim that there's evidence. So this is big news, really big news. The wow is surfacing. The wow is really surfacing. And it was in a felt way, the entire body, even my toes, the whole was tingling, kind of. The whole body was, I was feeling this overall feeling, different feeling. Actually, I was feeling like I did when I was young. So regaining that perspective, much clearer perspective. Everything is vertical before the world did its, thug act on me, as it does on everyone. The world's like a rogue pirate ship full of vicious thugs, vicious ideological thugs, and being born aboard that pirate ship, it's very, very, very brutal. So this was, way more advanced than I've been before. So this is a new norm now. I'm establishing the new norm here. And this is what we do every day. Establish a new norm. Go big or go home. I mean, have to establish a new normal every day. Otherwise, we don't want to stall out because, the hounds of hell are nipping at our heels here. Interesting, that dog was constantly kicking, scratching, this mangy looking dog. I'm sure it was like kicking fleas all over the place, and those fleas then jump in your socks, you bring them home, right? Now they're in the house. It's not a civilized thing to do, to bring dogs into public places like that, enclosed public places. But it's kind of like the world. I mean, the world's, we think, oh, the world's so nice, but it has a lot of fleas, a lot of fleas. Sometimes those fleas can build up. We had a situation back many years ago with our dog, and it got bad fleas. It was really a big flea problem, and for some reason, hard to explain, but our entire yard got infested with fleas. You couldn't walk out of the house without hundreds of fleas jumping on you. And it was hideous, absolutely hideous. We had to use flea bombing in the house, all the carpets, many, many, many times, because the inside was also infested. It was one of the most terrible things imaginable. So, plagues happened. I don't know how it got so bad. It was quite extraordinary. The dog was hard to bathe. It's a huge dog, heavy dog. It kept picking up fleas, and anyway, this is the world. I mean, the world can get a severe case of fleas, and it can get way worse than we expect, actually. History points out the instability that takes place here in this world. So we are working to sidestep that. Now, abidance in the wow, abidance in the wow, abidance in the wow. We say full stop in the wow. This is when we practice really intensely, we're intentionally bringing up the wow. But it's starting to go more towards abidance in the wow now, for me. Also, I got a wow when I said to the Holy Spirit, to Jesus, to all the great sages, I said, hey, go ahead and help me out as much as you possibly can. Even if I don't know what you're doing, it's okay. Doesn't matter. I don't have to know. You know, whatever healing you want to do, whatever you want to do this way, that way, go ahead and just do it. You don't have to tell, you don't have to, I don't have to be aware of it. I don't have to say, okay, this is what you're doing. I'm not going to keep an account of it. Just go, just do it. Absolutely do everything now. And this is a huge change. I felt a tremendous shockwave of wow go over me. And there's nothing better than the wow, really. It's just, I live for the wow. Yeah, that's, I live for the wow. We can't go on without it. Now, da 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 da. And we live for the wow. Boom, 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 boom. Old surf song, kind of back in the 60s. Or a pseudo surf song. Sun song. Sun, sun. Yep. That was Southern California beach culture music, which was the coolest thing imaginable back then in the 60s. I mean, the 60s were terrible in a lot of ways. Everything's terrible here, but the SoCal beach culture was made everybody kind of feel like, hey, maybe we can be happy if we just lived in Southern California. You know, maybe we might be happy. False hope, for sure. I don't know if they've ever come up with anything quite as appealing since then, actually. You know, the Malibu houses with their big patios overlooking the Pacific Ocean, and the dance parties, live bands there, you know, and watching the sunset and the sunrise, go out surfing in the morning, swimming, and then just spend all day just hanging out on the beach and jogging, and it was just like, it was awesome. Awesome beach culture. We tried to imitate that up here in Northern California. The water was too cold. It was freezing, you know. I grew up in beach culture, Northern California beach culture, but the water was just like ice. Yeah, it wasn't so nice. And the fog, cold fog, would come in, and never, it was never really the, I always envy the SoCal beach culture, you know. That was just like, the ultimate. But we can have the wow culture now. The wow culture. Why not? That'll even beat the SoCal beach culture, actually. Feels like it's coming. Like the Paul McCartney Wing song, coming up like a flower, coming up. Feels like it's coming up. It's coming. It's emerging. It's emerging now. Surfacing. Emerging. Surfacing. This steady wow. There's nothing dependent on contrast. There's no life dependent on contrast at all. This bogus belief in contrast. Actually, everything just is. You know, Immanuel Kant said there's no thing in itself. Well, actually, everything, all is all in itself. Everything is thing in itself. There's no such thing as not thing in itself. Really, you want to flip that script. All is all in itself. There's only thing in itself. There isn't anything other than that. There's no contrast in reality, actually. You know, this is something. This is an arbitrary notion that we have of perception of contrast. And of course, the body is the tool we use to make it seem like contrast is real and important. Perception, sensory perception. That's why we engineered the body. Imagine the body into being, not even being, but into appearancing. Because the senses act what we call contrast, but it's just selectivity, actually. So this is very pragmatic information to hear. I hope someday, well, I know someday I'll be helping out in some way. We all will in some way. One thing, it seems to me, if there's some Yanni, J-N-A-N-I, Yanni, non-dual realized, you know, abiding in the wowness of now, someone here like that, it's too difficult just to go see them. You know, you can't. It's too difficult. What they should do, in my opinion, is anyone who comes to see him is on probation. If you start out with probation, strict probation, and you just sit there quietly, there's no interaction. You're on strict probation, just starting out. And then that strict probation is relaxed, you know, bit by bit by bit, for those who, you know, are able to handle it. But really, the shock of it, of going to see a true Yanni, is immeasurable shock. Actually, it's a how in the this casualness, you know, that just, oh yeah, we're gonna go see this non-dual teacher, just come in, oh, how you doing? Okay, ask some questions. What do you think about this? I mean, what in the world is that? I don't get that at all. It puts way, 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 way too much shock and pressure on the ones that are coming to see someone. There should be some strict protocol that protects those from shock, the shock of it. If I wanted to see someone, I'd want to be put on strict probation too. Say you have to sit at a distance here and be quiet and just observe, and let that go on until you feel mature enough that you can handle the wow of the situation. Sit at a distance and observe. That should be, everyone should start out without any exception. Everyone should start out that way. If I went to see someone, myself included, I would include myself. This is extraordinary, you know. Going to see a realized sage is the rarest of the rare opportunity. It is the most beneficial, sublime opportunity possible. I mean, it just goes on and on and on and on and on. And we're, you know, this is just unprecedented shock. You can't just have this California casual beach culture thing. Hey man, you know, yeah, how you doing? And I'm doing all right. Give me five, you know. And so, you know, how can I be happy? Tell me about happiness. You know, just kind of, no, that's robbing yourself, dispossessing yourself of the situation. It is misinterpreting it. The true Yanni is not seeing any life based on contrast at all. They realize contrast is not causative. It doesn't really even exist. It's imaginary. What they're seeing is so different than, you know, they're seeing everything as perfectly vertical. And what they have to say just extraordinary. People just assume, well, I know what they're going to say. You kind of, you know, and there's more to it. The presence, just everything, everything. We went to see Ramana Maharshi, I'd say, let me, you know, sit outside the ashram for a week or so, or, you know, or however long. I don't even go inside to start off with. I wouldn't even go inside. I just sit in quiet meditation, wowness, just outside first. It'd probably be extraordinarily intense. Because you start thinking, hey, I'm going to go in, I'm going to be going in there at some point. And there's the realized sage, you know. I'm not ready for that. I'll sit outside the ashram for a while until then. Maybe I might go into the ashram and go sit in a far corner. Maybe I might sit in the far corner for months. Probably just shaking and trembling, you know. And only gradually, would you get any sort of, you know, familiarity. Bit by bit by bit, the sage would give you a little bit of, you know, maybe a glance and smile or walk past you or something. Gradually, you know, ease into it. You have to ease into it. What is the world thinking? You know, the insane lack of a spiritual culture and a spiritual protocol is ruinous. I mean, reestablishing spiritual protocol is seems like an impossible task right now. So if I knew there was true realized sage somewhere, first of all, I'd sit in the wow of it for until I could move. Then I might like drive, you know, within, you know, I don't know, 10 miles, 20 miles or something, and just stop there and realize I'm just 10 miles away from this sage. And then I might move, you know, 5 miles away or something, and spend time 5 miles away. And then I might get like 1 mile away. As I'm only 1 mile away, I'd say it's just 1 mile from here, and then maybe I'd be down the block, you know, or some, and only step by step by step by step by step would I dare presume, you know, to even get close in that way. People can spend a lifetime preparing to meet a sage. That's what I've certainly done. I've spent my whole life hoping I could one day finally meet a sage. Be in the presence of a sage, rather. Because that's extraordinarily auspicious. That can light a fire. Yeah, really, a wow. That can really, really bring you along very rapidly. Provided that you know, ease your way into it and account for the wow at all times. In India, they have the, up till recently, I mean, they understood the spiritual protocol. Great sages walking along, people keep a respectful distance with, they're in a state of, hands like this is handling the wow. They're in an extreme state of wow. This is just so intense. And in those who go to, at least in the proximity of the great sage, they get on their knees and they prostrate, and they put their head to the ground and submission, total submission, meaning, don't be too intense, don't be too intense. They're already on the ground, so they don't drop. Only a few actually are standing, walking with the sage, actually. Those who've been with them a long time who are particularly capable of doing that. And then the sage comes up and approaches. If they're going to approach, they might approach somebody, and but you don't have people running up and approaching, generally speaking at all. This allows the profundity of it to sink in. Otherwise, it's still superficial. It remains too superficial. What does the sage have to say? My gosh, the sages, what they have to say is we've never heard anything like it. So this protocol is very important aspect of the spiritual path, which is one of the reasons why we're failing so terribly in the world right now. Keep in mind that great sages, their presence can extend for miles around about them. Very powerful. You could be sitting at quite a distance and still get a tremendous boost, unprecedented intensity at a distance here. So this is a functional culture would understand spiritual protocol very clearly and abide by it. Now the Westerners like Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj because he wasn't a stickler for that much protocol. Some he kicked a lot of people out because they weren't behaving correctly. He said, "Get out of here! You come back when you understand. So you're not being a disruption and all this." So he had to be strict. People said, "Oh, you're so strict! You're so strict!" No, but nobody knew how to handle the protocol really. Sage walk down the street, people follow him at a respectful distance wherever they go. The sage goes in a store, they remain outside the store waiting. Sage comes outside the store, walks somewhere else, they all walk behind them. Like, geese following the mother goose or something. They didn't importune the sage with all these grievances and problems. "Hey, fixed it." No, are they kidding? They said, this is a much greater opportunity here. This is not some bureaucrat here. This is someone that realizes the truth, that we can drop the whole notion of contrast between subtlety and grossness, of subtle fixation and gross fixation, and realize there's no fixation. And drop the notion that the difference between subtle and gross constitutes some sort of life. The difference between the illusion of subtle fixation and the illusion of gross fixation, the idea that it constitutes a life, that's the lifeblood of creation, a life, is utter nonsense. And this is what everyone here believes. You cannot mix beach culture, SoCal beach culture, with the situation of seeing an enlightened sage. You cannot really mix the two. There has to be a very strict protocol. You have to, be advised of it and recognize it and abide by it, so for your own benefit. So the kickback's not too strong, the backlash, the wow is not too strong. You can't have the party culture. You can't mix them. You can't mix. Now we think that we've gotten rid of all this because we say, well, it was all a myth. There's nobody worth that. There's no situation that's worth it. So it was all just a sham, farce. This is, extreme folly to think that way. Look at Sri Sri Anandamayi Maya, very strict protocol, and she had helpers that made sure it was followed. Very, the ashrams, who stayed at the ashram, very, 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 very strict on everybody. Especially Westerners, because they didn't know the protocol, they had a very tough time. And we say there's no that was all just folly. There's no one is deserving of that, or no situation calls for that. This is just capitulation, up to the ego, what the world is doing right now. They say, we can just be this super, super casual, never, no follow no protocol. Should be saying protocol. I just haven't used that word in a long time. It just shows you how rusty we are, right? Saying protocol is protocol. You never hear that anymore, hardly. We're sinking. The ship is sinking. You have to have this protocol, based on the situation. If someone's really, super, super, super valuable, then the situation should be approached as such. Protocol with heads of state, but a yani is immeasurably more valuable. This is the capability of telling us, pointing out to us, the absolute folly we're engaged in. That nothing is fixated. There's no fixation. Now, I've not been able to find, you know, enlightened Yanni here, or Yanni. I mean, it just has to be I'm not ready, you know? I mean, this is a hard thing to take, but what other conclusion could there be? It's not their fault, you know? They're not saying nobody can come, you know? It's our fault. This thing is not recording properly at all. It's skipping along here. Every 3 seconds it skips along. So I don't know if this is actually recording properly or not. It's doing 3 second skips. Wow. I found out today why driving in the Silicon Valley is so stressful, so stressful. It's because every single freeway on-ramp there is a constant steady stream of cars merging, and it makes freeway driving very difficult. If you don't go in the fast lane or middle lane, because they're driving too fast in those lanes. So you go, oh, I got to take it easy in the slower lane. The speed limit. You try to do the speed limit in the slow lane. Then you have to deal with all the steady, these cars merging every on-ramp. And there's no space, you know, to let them in. It's a solid, they're bumper to bumper almost. And they're trying to merge. And you have to, like, you're slow down. And they kind of slow down. And then you both speed up together and you slow down together. But then you run out of room. You know, it's hard to know how to play it. Do you slow down or do you speed up? Today I started slowing down, and I said, oh, they're parallel with me. This is going to be a problem. So I started speeding up. Well, they speeded up at the same time. And, you know, big trouble. We're running out of room. So I hit the horn real hard and just floored it and got past them. But, you know, a lot of people will slow down. As you slow down, they keep slowing down. That messes things up. So nobody really knows how to handle this because it's too many cars. I mean, normally on ramps, you know, there's some space between cars coming on, and then you can just, you know, allow them to go in front, or you slip in front of them. There's some space, but if they're just solid, it's a real problem. And this is what is taking place here. It's driving me nuts. Every day is like, oh no, here comes another on ramp. You know, how am I going to deal with this one? You never know what the drivers are going to do. I mean, we're not reading each other's minds, you know. Are you going to slow up or are you going to speed down and play this dance every damn darn exit? So I seen that, I said, oh my gosh, no wonder why it's getting so terrible and stressful here. You know, those are very harrowing things. I mean, when you start running out of room, you got two cars. And another thing is the middle lane is so full of cars, you can't run the middle lane to get out of the way. I mean, that's the best thing to do. You see stream of cars, you get over the middle lane. But if it's completely canal, whatever they're doing, it's over. So you're trapped. And everybody's going. So, the protocol. If you're going to see them, then there has to be, you know, crazy not to have protocol. Be still and be quiet. At a distance, quiet. So wow, look with it and see that you're shaking, you're trembling. You say, oh my, what am I doing? This is, can I, you know, so many things to surface and look at them. Let that, you know, come to light and let it naturally evaporate. It's all about evaporating the calm bit by bit. From it's not about the body at all. There's no contrast. There's nothing. Contrast is not seen as causative. It's not, in fact, it's seen it doesn't even exist. Except construct, contrast, difference between light and dark, for instance. Just a belief-based contrast between the two, actually. Contrast, there's no life, belief in a life based on any cause, no belief in the personality at all. On and on and on. You know, abide. In the total vertical, everything is seen as vertical. It's just a completely different than what we're used to, or any of us have been used to, actually. So we can't just waltz out like, hey, what's up, dude? This is, been trained in any protocol, spiritual protocol. This is how decadent, how fallen nation is, actually. Listen to the audio and see if it's actually recording. I don't know if it's recording properly. It's hearing, it's good through the headphones. With you, you put your phone on, you sit silently, quiet, don't be milling around, relax the need for action. That's how the wow rises. If you stay in the action mode, the wow tends not to be shocks, it stuns us. Now, for me, I used to do it every day, quite a bit. Sometimes it's autopilot with driving. Just it's autos can arise very strongly while I'm driving. Still, right in the vehicle, you're getting pretty doggone still. Don't socialize. You're not there to socialize. Shit like that. Wow. Find it. It's there. You're essentially, your life will never be the same. Irreversible in recognizing that the life that we presume has been created and is being sustained by contrast, this such a life doesn't exist at all. Never has, never will. Contrastive. It's not even, it doesn't even exist, actually. So don't, you know, you don't go with questions. That's That's the way, way, way is what to do. It's managing the success. The very fact that you've gone to the yoni and you're going to see one is such extreme success on your path that you can't even measure it. So if you reckon, come with elation and just, you know, almost out of, you know, beside yourself with the massive great. I might know where you can go to see good fortune. I don't even know where to go to see anyone. Ordinarily great good fortune. One has to recognize the great good fortune. Look at the true, honest, and get used to it as a new norm. So it's just a matter of continuously establishing a new norm, but it would be, you know, speed. So those who are good at doing that are able, say, to approach a yoni gradually, bit by, because they keep establishing a norm. And gradually you get used to the expectations. You have to find out what the expectations are. One time, very intelligent cat, so much so that people swore it's not possible. A lot of people thought it was some sort of sage cat, actually. It just showed up one day and just stared at me right in the eyes like that. Not advancing, not just soup stare. I just stared back. I just said, "Well, yes." Looking to see if I would accept it. Said, "Okay." I just said. Instantly, the cat then walked up to me, at a little distance, just looking at me like that. And as soon as I gave some sort of approval, the cat instantly walked up to me, then it. I let it in the house, even though there'd be resistance to that. I said, "No, okay, you're good. You can stay here." That's what it wanted. It began to learn the rules of the house, the pro way, and it was obvious. It would do something, and you say no, and then it would look like that, and you could tell that it was. And there's the protocol of this house. And I think it only made one mistake or something, and then it was very apologetic, and you know, you could tell. It's like, hey, you know. This cat, you know, was totally tuned to this. You know, there's a protocol in this house, and it followed it, you know, perfectly. It's that, you know, 100 times quicker than a human being could. You know, human being to that cat. If it was anywhere at all, outside, inside, whatever, you just whistle, running, and it'll come right up to you, and stand there and then look at, like, okay, I'm here. What do you want? One time I did that, you know, just to see if it would come, and I said, "Well, I don't really have anything for it." And he's kind of like, the cat just looked like, and, you know, be serious here. It's a cat. So I felt bad about that. So I never did that again. But because it would instantly drop whatever it was doing, sleeping, whatever. If you whistle for that cat, it would jump and run to where you were. And say, whatever you want, tell me what you want, and I'll do it. The obedient cat, the protocol cat. You know, this will show you, there's a protocol. And everybody still speaks about that cat, saying that was no cat. Now, I didn't think it was a cat either, really. It was some sort of sage. I don't know what. How to put it, but the cat looked at you. That was not a cat looking at you at all, the way it behaved and looked. You know, most animals, they look in an animal way. This was not an animal looking at you. This was like intelligence, you know, looking at consciousness, like pure consciousness looking at you and just looking right through you read, like reading your thoughts. I mean, I could read my thoughts, you know. I just knew everything I was thinking, what I wanted, everything. It was just, you know, it's completely psychic, you would say. The cat's tail was broken at the end, and I always thought that would mean at some point this world's going to break. There's a break coming. Or maybe it was like a big break in a positive sense. There's a really big break coming at some point. Or there's some distortion, terrible distortion coming, or a side trip. So there's a message there with its tail. It was very noticeably a broken tail at an angle. And I never was quite sure exactly what that meant. Maybe it's pointing out the world is going to be broken. It's really broken. You got to prepare for the brokenness of the world. And the cat helped me out tremendously. It helped get me serious. Stop messing around. Stop fooling around. It didn't like you playing around with it and being too rough for whatever. You said, hey, start being serious, real serious here, treating everything just the right way. And if you were just bugging it, turn around and nip you. It had perfect control over its mouth, and it just give you a little tiny little nip like that, and then look at you like that, and you say, okay, I'm sorry, I got it. And then that was it. It was the end of it. So the cat said, hey, treat me with respect, treat me with dignity. There's a protocol here. And so it was like training me. I got trained. I had to change my behavioral characteristics to for the because the cat. It was like a guru, actually. It really was like a spiritual guru in the form of a cat. It's very different than other cats or other animals, that is for sure. Then the other cat I had that just passed away was like bliss incarnate. Incarnation of bliss. The cat would just look at you. Come up to you and just look at you in bliss. And you're just purring and just bliss. All the time in bliss. Uncaused bliss. Nothing was causing it, It was like so happy to see you. You come home and the cat would just slowly walk up to you just saying, wow, I'm just so great to see you. I'm so thrilled to see you. And it just hang out with you, just in this natural bliss all the time. It was amazing. And you can see the cat was in ecstasy all the time. It wasn't like a normal cat. The cat was like in the wow, in this abiding, in this tremendous wow all the time. And I said, cat, don't leave us. You're important. We need that here, man. And maybe the cat said, well, it's time that you get with it. Get with it like that, too. We had the cat door closed. And the last day of its life, the last morning of its life, it somehow managed to walk, climb down from a sofa, walk, and then somehow opened the cat door by itself and got outside. It was the most extraordinary thing. Maybe it's showing, look, even when the world's really sick, you can escape it. It's trying to hem you in.